Thanks very much. And thanks for everyone who put in the effort of bringing me here, as well as all of you for showing up. So I guess the key question at the end of the talk will be, have I faithfully represented any of these images? And therefore, have I captured productivity? From what I gather, some of the lectures that have come beforehand have sort of focused on the issue of sort of how productivity is defined in political economy, and sort of the production of productive subjectivity. So what I am going to do to hopefully sort of add to this conversation is to focus on the role that production plays in capitalist society. Because it seems to me, and perhaps you will disagree, that you cannot have productivity without understanding production. And without understanding what production is and how it sort of operates within capitalist society, then you know, might also not understand how production works, or productivity works. Unfortunately, I don't get into sort of the important issue of productive or unproductive labor, even though I do sort of mention the notion of social reproduction. So, apologies. Perhaps that's something that can come up in conversation. Okay. So I'm going to be boring and sort of just read what I wrote. No sort of lasers, no PowerPoints, no video links or anything. Old fashioned, but brought to you by one of the modern forms of productivity, the laptop. In March 2005, Axel Honneth gave the Tanner Lectures on Human Values at UC Berkeley, where he first put forward his influential recognition theoretical reinterpretation of reification. These lectures, in turn, form the basis of his book, Reification, A New Look at an Old Idea. This was published in 2008, which of course was the same year as the collapse of Lehman Brothers and the onset of the global financial crisis. The latter, triggered by the autonomous dynamic of exchange that compelled individuals' actions, and the purportedly differentiated realms of the economy, state, and civil society, signify that the Marxian elements of the old idea of reification were unfortunately still alive and well. Yet Honneth's new look at this old idea held otherwise. And in the years that followed, as the financial crisis transformed into a social crisis, so did the propensity to engage with Honneth's reformulation, or to follow Honneth, formulating new interpretations of reification and critical theories that eschewed the issue of crisis, and indeed the aspect of Lukács' theory that drew on Marx's critique of political economy. There are sort of a number of articles on Honneth's interpretation of reification, and a number that sort of follow him in suit. And it seems to me that this was surprising for several reasons. In the first place, it would seem to logically follow that new critical theoretical formulations of reification would respond to the reemergence of capitalism's crisis tendencies by utilizing reification to account for and critique crisis-ridden contemporary society. Whereas Lukács notes in his 1967 preface, history and class consciousness is representative of the great crisis it was composed of. Furthermore, although the theory of reification is often criticized for its methodological ambiguity and its socio-theoretical one-dimensionality, it is often missed that Lukács' theory also contends that crises are the inherent and reoccurring outcomes of the structural dynamic of production for exchange in reified capitalist society. In addition, critical theory originally developed in a context of crisis. Indeed, it is also overlooked that the critical theory of society, as originally developed by Horkheimer, used Marx's critique of political economy in order to construe crises as an inherent aspect of the object of critique. The reified form of social production constitutive of capitalist society. Yet the absence of these aspects of reification in Honneth's, as well as Andrew Feinberg and Anita Shari's reformulations of reification, has led to what I think is an unfortunate irony. There's been a proliferation of critical theories that have adapted reification to criticize pathological relations within society, rather than considering how the elements of the theory of reification that drew on Marx's critique of value might be utilized for a critical theory of the crisis-ridden dynamic of the reified form of contemporary society as such. And this in turn has led, I think, contemporary critical theoretical interpretations of reification to an impasse. For it seems to me that contemporary society calls for a critique of its crisis-ridden form of reproduction, which these new formulations of reification are ill-suited to provide. So in what follows, I move towards developing this contemporary critical theory by delineating the relationship the early Horkheimer demarcated between the aspect of reification that drew on the critique of political economy and the critical theory of society. And in so doing, I argue that a critical theory of reification that draws on Marx's critique of value, construing crises as inherent to the reified form of social production and reproduction, is more suitable for a critical theoretical interpretation of reification in our present moment than the recent reformulations of reification, which on the basis of what I call post-Habermasian presuppositions that shape much of contemporary critical theory, have eschewed the critique of political economy and thus bracketed a systematic explication of crisis-ridden social reproduction, and of course with it, the issue of production and productivity, in order to conceive of reification as a pathology within society. So I do this in three parts. First, I show how these recent reinterpretations of reification operate within the presuppositions of post-Habermasian critical theory, refraining from using the elements of Lukács' theory that drew on the critique of value in order to construe reification in terms of what I call the pathological overreach of institutional rationality into realms of intersubjective reason. Yet since I show that these very same presuppositions effectively naturalize and try to democratically regulate reified social production and reproduction, I claim that these new interpretations are ill-suited for grasping and thus critiquing crisis, which leads me to sort of move back, back to sort of the classics, and re-examine the relationship between reification and crisis in Lukács and Horkheimer. And here I argue sort of counterintuitively, perhaps, that Horkheimer has a notion of reification and crisis that marks an unacknowledged advancement over what I argue is a foreshortened and fragmentary accounts in Luke catch. For Horkheimer's critical theory, as a critique of the antagonistic social constitution, of the super-individual, autonomous, inverted, and socially objective dynamic of exchange, which mediates social production and the state, compelling individuals on both sides of a class relation, leading to a historical trajectory that inevitably triggers crises, seems to me to propound a critical theory of the crisis-ridden reproduction of the reified form of society. In the final parts, I close by arguing for the relevance of Horkheimer's conception. And I do so by sort of providing an account of the trajectory of the crisis and arguing that Horkheimer's theory is, you know, more applicable to this trajectory. So, part one. For those of you who are not sort of well engrossed in this issue of reification or contemporary critical theory, this may be sort of a bit abstruse. But I will ask you to bear with me, because once we get around to the end of the paper, you'll see that it was well worth it. Since I will show that Honneth, Feinberg, and Shari's reinterpretations of reification are shaped by a number of key conditions within the post, what I call the post-Habermasian paradigm of critical theory, in this section I first outline these assumptions. Then I turn to show how they mold their respective interpretations, and close by showing how these interpretations are ill-suited for critiquing crises. So unsurprisingly, as the term indicates, these post-Habermasian presuppositions are shaped by Habermas, particularly, you know, Habermas's reformulation of critical theory and reification. And they stem from his contention that the critical theory of Horkheimer and Adorno lacked a sufficient normative standpoint and possessed a totalizing one-dimensional social theory in which instrumental reason pervaded society. Now, the theory of communicative action that Habermas developed was intended to redress these perceived weaknesses. At its heart lay the distinction between the system and the life world, the former consisting in the norm-free and differentiated systematic institutions of the market and the states, were held to be necessary elements of contemporary societies, while the latter, as the realm of communicative reason, provided Habermas with a sufficient normative standpoint that he held was lacking in Adorno and Horkheimer's critical theory. So as a whole, the social theory incumbent on the system and the life world is said to provide a notion of society as one of what is called complex differentiation, rather than one-dimensionality. Yet, as Helmut Reichelt points out, such a social theory provided Habermas with a distinctly new conception of critical theory. As noted, Habermas's notion of the system meant that the institutions of the market and the state were no longer the objects of criticism. Money was defined as a neutral medium, and antagonistic class relations of production were replaced with a model of intersubjectivity. Consequently, the form of capitalist production and reproduction were effectively naturalized. This stood, of course, in marked contrast not only to Marx's critique of political economy, which as a critique of social objectivity accounted for the manner in which antagonistic social labor constitutes and reproduces the autonomous and inverted forms of capital, wherein the dynamic of exchange compels individual actions on both sides of a class relation, shaping productivity in a manner that inevitably triggers crises of social reproduction. But also to the critical theory of Horkheimer and Adorno, For their notion of the critical theory of society put this conception of the social objectivity of exchange at the center of its understanding of society. And such a critical theory of society was primarily concerned with the genetic explication of society understood as the totality of these inverted forms. It was a critical theory of the reproduction of the reified form of society as such. Whereas Habermas, in contrast, conceived a critical theory as a critical theory within society. A critical theory that, in light of the naturalizing of the system, no longer rested on criticizing society in terms of its reified form of social reproduction, but instead addressed the relationship between these purportedly necessary differentiated spheres of the system and the life world. Consequently, rather than improving on the aspects of Lukács' theory of reification that drew on Marx, as I will show Horkheimer did, Habermas recast reification as a pathology that described when the necessary norm-free and differentiated institutions of the system, again the market and the states, overstepped their bounds and colonized the life world. A pathology that can be remedied by instituting normative standards of intersubjective action, notably deliberative democracy and sort of redistributive policies that follow from it, as the proper type of mediation between the system and the life world. As a further consequence of this, as Reichelt also notes, Habermas's sundering of this relationship between reification and the critique of political economy likewise eliminated Marx's account of crises from his reformulation of critical theory. Consequently, Habermas did not conceive of crises as inherent to the historically specific dynamic of valorization, qua production, productivity, and reproduction in capitalist societies. It treated them more in terms of unique occurrences of disequilibrium between the differentiated domains of the system and the life world, which by extension might be said to hold that they are, were inherent to the functional equilibrium of any contemporary society. Now, these elements of Habermas's reformulation of critical theory became fundamental presuppositions that molded post-Habermasian critical theory. Most importantly, as I now show, Honneth, Feinberg, and Chary's recent reinterpretation of reification are shaped by these assumptions. For all three refrain from critiquing the antagonistic and reified form of production and reproduction of capitalist society in favor of a normative social theory of complex differentiation, in which the necessary function of the differentiated systematic institutions of the state and the economy are internally distinct and separated from the domain of intersubjective reason. In so doing, they jettison the aspect of Lukács' theory that drew on Marx, following Habermas insofar as they propound critical theories that conceive of reification as a social pathology of disequilibrium, wherein these functionally necessary systematic components of contemporary society have overstepped their normative bounds, colonizing and disrupting realms of intersubjective reason, and with it the possibility of the empathic democratic mediation of society. Now, since Feinberg and Chary's interpretation of reification both criticize and mirror Honneth, I first discuss how Honneth's Habermasian presuppositions, coupled with his dismissal of the Marxian elements of Lukács' theory, eschew a critical theory of crisis. I then turn to show how Feinberg and Chary's interpretations follow suit. Am I reading at a good pace? People can follow.
You can do it a bit faster.
Oh, I don't know about that. Might confuse myself. And then we'd all be in trouble. And then productivity would just go out the window. Despite an allusion to the crisis-ridden context Lukács' theory is formulated in, Honneck's influential interpretation of reification thus rests on post-Habermasian presuppositions that lead to a number of moves and distinct interpretations that eradicates the aspect of Lukács' theory that draws on Marx's critique of value. Bracketing the question of the form of production and reproduction in favor of an interpretation of reification that pertains to the pathological instrumental deformation of intersubjective relations of recognition. But it should be noted, only pathological instrumental deformed relations of recognition that occur outside the economic sphere. Indeed, it is on the basis of the assumption of complex differentiation that Honneck challenges what he calls Lukács' Marxist premise, that involvement in economic exchange processes is assumed to have such a profound significance for individuals that it engenders a permanent change or even a total disruption of their entire set of relations between themselves and the world. For in Honneck's view, not only is Marx's theory of commodity fetishism concerned with the narrow focus of the economic sphere, but is not even appropriate there. Instead, following Habermas, Honneck holds that, quote, the instrumental relations that obtain within the economic sphere are regulated or required by highly developed societies. Consequently, whilst Honneck perceptively points to a number of ambiguities in Lukács' accounts, which I return to below, these points are aligned with Honneck's notion of complex differentiation, ultimately serving as justification for Honneck to cast off the Marxian element of Lukács' theory in order to separate the economic sphere from the one of intersubjective reason, thus bracketing the issue of production and reproduction in order to treat reification as a distorted form of misrecognition. So Honneck thus argues that Lukács replaces what he calls the official functionalist Marxian basis of reification a few pages into the reification essay with the Weberian accounts of rationalization. Following his post-Habermasian presuppositions, Honneck then asserts that Lukács' use of Marx and Weber is not tenable outside the sphere of commodity exchange, rendering them insufficient for the task of justifying the idea of reification as a second nature. And this leads Honneck to argue that Lukács' conceptual shift of perspective towards transformations occurring in the subject's own style of acting provides a more appropriate basis for second nature. According to Honneck, this is because the concepts of contemplation and detachment are what become essential to the explanation of what takes place in the modus of reification at the level of social agency. On this basis, Honneck argues that reification can be diagnosed as a pathology, wherein the socialization of instrumental reason in this realm of intersubjectivity has atrophied or distorted what a more primordial and genuine form of praxis, in which humans take up an empathic and engaged relationship between themselves and their surroundings. And from this, it follows that the remedy for reification is intersubjective recognition, which restores this empathic and engaged relationship in this realm. Yet, as can hopefully be seen, on its post-Habermasian presuppositions underlay and inform this reinterpretation of reification, providing justification for jettisoning the Marxian aspect of Lukács' theory, and thus separating the pathological socialization of instrumental rationality in this realm of intersubjectivity from the necessary sphere of instrumental action, the modern institution of the economy, which is deemed appropriate for any sort of contemporary society. In so doing, Honneth's interpretation entirely evacuates Lukács' account of the manner in which the dominating super-individual dynamic of reified society compels production for exchange in a manner that inevitably triggers crises, and of the manner in which reified consciousness perpetuates such a dynamic. And instead, his reformulation operates within this post-Habermasian paradigm. Here the relationship, or here the separation, between the system and the life world is reflected in the naturalization of the economic sphere and its separation from the object of critique, the domain of intersubjective recognition. Consequently, in reformulating reification along what he terms unofficial lines as a case of pathological disequilibrium, in which instrumental reason has essentially colonized the realm of intersubjective reason, inducing detachment rather than recognition, Honneth's critique of reification passes over the reified form of social reproduction and the phenomenon of crisis and silence. In contrast to Honneth, whom Andrew Feinberg criticizes for propounding a psychological interpretation of the contemplative aspect of reification, Feinberg argues that Lukács conceives of reification as a dialectical social theory of structure and agency. And on this basis, Feinberg's reformulation moves to interpret this very same aspect of Lukács' theory in what he argues is a manner credible in our time. Now, to do this, he rethinks reification outside the framework of Lukács' Marxist assumptions. And he does this in a manner that is shaped by post-Habermasian presuppositions. Because like Habermas, Feinberg conceives of reification as a systematic and necessary type of technological rationality, appropriate for these necessary institutions of the political and economic spheres. But at the same time, once again, it's the story of this type of rationality colonizing the life world. So from this perspective, Feinberg conceives of Lukács' notion of second nature and contemplation as pertaining to the technically manipulative relation to the world agents are engendered to take by the pathological overreach of a systematic structure. Further mirroring Habermas, he argues that the democratization of these institutions will provide the proper mediation between structure and agency, system and life world. In so doing, he brings his reinterpretation of reification into view. Yet in dismissing Marx, he refrains from criticizing these aspects of Marx's critique of political economy that I'm pointing to. And following Habermasian assumptions, seeks to address and remedy the relations of disequilibria between social institutions and the realm of intersubjectivity within society. Last but not least, Anita Shari, in her new and important, I think an interesting work, The Political Economy of the Senses, likewise criticizes Honneth's reformulation of reification for sacrificing the core of the concept, which forged a connection between the socio-economic structure of capitalist domination and the unengaged spectatorial stance human beings take towards the social world. showing how they together impede emancipatory transformation. In contrast, what she calls her reconstruction of reification puts forward an incisive critique of post-Habermasian critical theory that is intended to unite the critique of political economy with what she calls radical democracy. Yet I think it is unfortunately the case that the object of her critique and what is bracketed, once again, the reified form of social production and reproduction, means that Shari's interpretation of reification unintentionally reproduces the presuppositions of post-Habermasian critical theory outlined above. Now, why is this the case? Well, it's because the focus of Shari's critique, as well as the Pashtunian interpretation of Marx that she relies on, leads to a truncated utilization of the critique of political economy, which of course brackets an account of social production and reproduction, qua the crisis cronin and prone antagonistic dynamic of valorization. Moreover, although Shari gestures towards the historically specific type of domination that Pashtun's interpretation of Marx promulgates, she also states that her work is intended to complement other Marxian aspects, or other Marxian accounts of neoliberalism that presumably address these dominating aspects of contemporary society. Yet as a result, she puts forward a political critique of neoliberal reification that is premised on a relationship that reproduces Habermas's social theory of complex differentiation, the neoliberal state, economy, and subjectivity. This means that, like Feinberg, Shari ultimately conceives of reification as a problem of structure and agency, wherein the pathological structure of neoliberalism, the entwinement of the state and the economy, which, interestingly enough, Shari seems to treat as specific to neoliberalism, has colonized subjectivity, thus rendering it spectatorial and depoliticized. Now, the political critique of reification that she proceeds to develop argues that critical theory should overcome these depoliticizing effects by grasping the relationship between subjectivity and the institutional structures of neoliberalism in both theory and practice. This leads her to call for a radical democratic mediation of structure and agency, citizens and institutions, that will remedy such a pathology. Yet, in doing this, also, as I showed, she overtly draws on the critique of political economy. It seems to me that the manner in which she formulates her critique of reification as a critique of a depoliticized political relation of disequilibrium between structural institutions and intersubjective radical democratic agency within society, rather than one focused on a socially objective dynamic of the form of antagonistic production and reproduction, echoes Feinberg, and still seems to be shaped by post-Habermasian presuppositions. So, sort of summarizing this section as a whole, well, as can be seen, despite Feinberg and Shari's criticisms upon it, it seems to me that all three thinkers formulate interpretations of reification that are shaped by the post-Habermasian paradigm. For in spite of Shari's utilization of Pashtun, rather than criticizing the reified form of society, all three seem to assume the necessity of institutional forms of the market and the states, and social theories that assume a norm of complex differentiation, wherein the necessary function of systematic institutions are separated from the domains of intersubjective reasoning. This leads these three thinkers to reformulate reification from the perspective of deficient passive relations agents possess as a result of this process of pathological colonization, which should be remedied by the social mediation of instrumental or intersubjective rationality in the form of recognition for Honneth, or in the form of democracy or radical democracy for Feinberg and Chari. These interpretations thus not only bracket crises from the object of critique, by aligning their interpretations of reification with a social theory of complex differentiation, rather than the critique of political economy, they foreclose the possibility of utilizing reification to provide a systematic critique of crisis, qua the reified form of reproduction that characterizes capitalist society's metabolic interaction with nature. As a consequence, as I show more fully in closing, these reformulations are ill-suited for critiquing crises, and by extension, contemporary society. Yet, as I mentioned above in the introduction, both Lukács and Horkheimer utilize this Marxian aspect of reification to conceive of crises as inherent to reified society, to which I now turn. I first show that Lukács' account of crisis as inherent to production for exchange is ultimately undermined by the ambiguities in his theory. And then I show how Horkheimer's interpretation of these elements of Lukács' critique of reified society take up and resolve these problems, pointing to a contemporary conception of a critical theory of crisis aligned with a critique of the reified form of social reproduction as such. So now I turn to Lukács. As indicated above, it is no exaggeration to say that Lukács' influential theory of reification has been roundly criticized for its explanatory insufficiency, theoretical eclecticism, totalizing and one-dimensional theory of society, and of course its theological conclusion. Yet as I will now show, what is often missed is that Lukács' ensuing explication of reification provides an account of crisis on the basis of his interpretation of Marx. In this purview, Lukács conceives of crises as intrinsic to the dynamic of production for exchange in reified capitalist society. They stem from the historically specific capitalist social division of labor, the separation of producers from the means of production, and of production from the sphere of circulation that characterize capitalist society, according to Lukács. They are caused by a dynamic that plays itself out within these domains, where the natural laws of capitalist second nature compels the capitalist class to rationalize production, mechanizing productivity, while at the same time depleting the workforce. This leads to a crisis when production cannot be realized in the sphere of exchange. Yet as I further show, this value theoretical element of Lukács' theory is ultimately undermined by its fragmentary and ambiguous nature, and the ensuing trajectory of the argument, which I think, perhaps controversially, mirrors post-Habermasian interpretations of reification. Insofar as Lukács ultimately holds that reification can be overcome not by abolishing the capitalist social division of labor, but by introducing the proper agent of social mediation, the proletariat. Now this means that Lukács' fragmentary critique of the crisis-ridden dynamic of reified reproduction is ultimately undermined and substituted for a critique within society, from the standpoint of the proletariat. Now, as I noted, Lukács' notion of crisis is given explication in the reification essay. On the basis of his explanation of the capitalist division of labor. Now here he draws on Marx, defining reification on the basis of fetishism, and which a relation between people takes on the character of a thing and thus acquires a phantom objectivity. An autonomy that seems so strictly rational and all-embracing as to conceal every trace of its fundamental nature, the relation between people. And due to the growth of the modern process of labor, of the isolated free labor and the division of labor, Lukács holds that the commodity has become the universal category of society as a whole, assuming decisive importance both for the objective evolution of society and for the stance adopted by men towards it. As a result, what Lukács indicates is of central importance to Marx's analysis of fetishism, that because of the situation of man's own activity, his own labor, becomes something objective and independent of him, something that controls him by virtue of an autonomy alien to man, is attributed with the creation of second nature. This means that the account of second nature that Lukács adumbrates is not concerned with the subjective stance of agents outside of the economic sphere, as Honneth claims, but in accounting for the servitude that such a second nature has created that corresponds to the commodity. So for Lukács, second nature thus consists in what he says are the laws governing these objects, which confront individuals as invisible forces that generate their own power, compelling people on both sides of the class relation to follow these natural laws. Now, of course, Weber's account of rationalization fits into this argument. Yet I don't think it does so in the way that Honneth, Feinberg, and Schori argue. Because, of course, following from these Marxian premises, these Weberian notions, or this Weberian account of rationalization, corresponds to the imperatives of valorization. This means that they are shaped by this dynamic of second nature. So that technical rationality consists in calculating how to rationalize production to generate profits, and contemplation to the way that producers respond to a process that operates according to these natural laws. In addition, what is often missed is that following this discussion of Weber, Lukács provides a description of crisis that corresponds to these Marxian elements. He returns to them. For in this discussion of crisis, it is second nature, as it plays itself out across the spheres of production and exchange, that triggers crises. This means that the unconscious natural law governing this process is one of unconscious constitution, autonomization, and compulsion, replicating Lukács's interpretation of Marx. Lukács provides an account of how and why such activity is realized in a dynamic that triggers crises by focusing on how it plays out and the incongruity between rationalized production and the sphere of circulation. Here, productivity is fully rationalized in accordance with the law of value. Capitalists are compelled to compete in accumulating capital by introducing a number of techniques that rationalize production, ultimately increasing productivity and depleting the workforce. But this process of rationalization is not coordinated between different competing capitalist firms, while the means of realizing it in the sphere of exchange are entirely contingent on purchase. Consequently, the whole structure of capitalist production rests on the interaction between a necessity, subject to strict laws, and all isolated phenomena, and the relative irrationality of a total process, which is more than just a postulate or a presupposition essential to the workings of a capitalist economy. It is at the same time the product of the capitalist social division of labor. Now, according to Lukács, this means that the true structure of society appears in these independent, rationalized, and formal partial laws, which can only establish fortuitous connections. And of course, this plays itself out in periods of crisis, where these formal links between production and exchange experience a sudden dislocation. Now, following this aspect of Lukács' account of crisis, we might say that this aspect of this account pertains to the aspect of his theory of reification that Honneth, Feinberg, and Charrie's reformulation eschews, Marx's critique of political economy. For Lukács, crises stem from the capitalist social division of labor, consisting in the separation of producers from the means of production, and of production from the sphere of circulation that characterizes capitalist society. Within it, the uncoordinated activity of competing capitalists constitutes these natural laws, which in turn compels them to rationalize production, increasing mechanization, whilst decreasing the workforce, leading to a further dynamic that triggers crisis, and production cannot be realized in the sphere of exchange. Now, following this trajectory, but this line of Lukács' theory would seem to imply a critique of the reified form of reproduction that rests on such a capitalist division of labor. However, as can be seen, the critique of crisis, qua the reproduction of reified society, that I've delineated is only fragmentary. In the first place, as indicated, this discussion of crisis only pertains to the relationship between production and exchange. No mention is made of the role of other institutions, such as the states, or how they play in such a, what they play in such a process, nor its wider social ramifications outside of these realms. Moreover, even in this domain, it leaves out an account of what triggers these crises, presumably the eroded purchasing power of the proletariat, which means that as a whole, this account of crisis does not amount to an account of reproduction, and thus of the misery the former inflicts on the latter in capitalist societies. This also raises an additional point, where, as I've indicated, Lukács accounts for how capitalists are compelled to rationalize production, but despite the aforementioned discussion of proletarian compulsion in the beginning of the reification essay, there is no mention of how the proletariat is compelled or affected by such a dynamic in regard to crisis, either in terms of how the rationalization of production transforms the compulsion to sell their labor power, or the miserable ramifications rationalization and crises have upon their ability to reproduce themselves. Instead, Lukács' account of the proletariat, while crisis is tied to sort of his, which ultimately undermines this notion of critique and crisis. For as Honneth indicates, the main trajectory of the argument in the reification identification essay depicts the objective and subjective aspects of reified totality on the basis of different explanatory strategies. That leads to a theological social theory premised on the standpoint of the proletariat. Which I can only summarize here in a very schematic manner. Essentially, part one provides an account of the material aspects of reification, indicative of the objectified relation of the object to bourgeois and proletarian subjects and social institutions. Part two provides an account of how the standpoint of bourgeois philosophy is reified because it is premised on the objectified relation of bourgeois subjects to this object. Part three discloses how the standpoint of the proletariat possesses a privileged epistemological standpoint, which discloses that these diverse types of reification, and by extension crises, are all parts of a totality, which they constitute, and in so doing, overcome their passivity, recognizing that their historical role is to seize this totality, and thus reunite subject and object. Now, it seems to me that this very same trajectory accounts both for the absence of the proletariat in Lukács' account of crisis, and ultimately undermines the fragmentary critique of reproduction of the crisis-ridden form of reified society I mentioned above. And this is because it is essential for the trajectory of this argument that his account of crisis contrasts capitalist compulsion with proletarian passivity. For if the proletariat was likewise dominated, atomized, and compelled by the law of value, and its crisis tendencies to reproduce society, they would not possess this privileged standpoint that can grasp and then seize totality. Instead, their passivity, coupled with this standpoint, sets up a conclusion, which in the end goes against what Lukács' foundational account of the capitalist social division of labor implies, that only its abolition will eradicate antagonism, autonomization, and crisis. For in accordance with this theological conclusion, it is sufficient for the proletariats to merely overcome their passivity and seize, rather than abolish, these reified institutions. As a whole, this means not only that Lukács' theory of crisis-ridden reproduction that draws on Marx's critique of political economy is incomplete. It also means that it is undermined and replaced by one in which crises and other types of social malaise merely stem from a passive relation the proletariat takes to the social structures they've created, a dialectic of structure and agency. As a result, Lukács' initial critique of reified society moves to a critique within society from the reified standpoints of the proletariat. This move on Lukács' part not only surprisingly echoes post-Habermasian presuppositions, diagnosing reification as a pathology of improper mediation within society, in discarding the fragmentary accounts of reified social reproduction, it also robs his account of reification of its potential suitability for pointing to a contemporary critical theory of crisis, and with it a critical theory of society as such. Yet, as I will now show, Horkheimer's early formulation of the critical theory of society holds such potential. Like the poet, I think I'm just going to skip this part. Essentially, I sort of discuss the way that the Frankfurt School, or at least Adorno and Horkheimer, are said to relate to Lukács, where it's not really grasped, I think, that they sort of provide a further development of his theory of reification. Instead, we hear these stories that they sort of take it up and turn it into this totalizing one-dimensional social theory. I argue that this isn't the case because of the following. In the first hand, Horkheimer's interpretation of capital consists in interpreting it in terms of the unconscious and antagonistic social constitution of a historically specific form-determined dynamic of social reproduction that delineates the internal relationship between spheres within society and compels antagonistic relations between individuals within the class relation. And this interpretation, Marx's method of presentation, begins with a super-individual, socially objective concept of value, and on this basis conceives of capital and money as a closed system. The dynamic of this socially objective system, in turn, mediates economic, political, and all other cultural fields, compelling antagonistic class relations. As a result, the critique of political economy, according to Horkheimer, comprehends the present form of society, which he characterizes as a real compulsiveness with which the production and reproduction of human life goes on in this epoch, the autonomy which the economic forces have acquired in respect to humanity, the dependence of all social groups on the self-regulation of the economic apparatus. Moreover, according to Horkheimer's interpretation, the socially objective dynamic in which exchange compels production and reproduction plays out in historical tendencies, ultimately triggering crises which institutions, individuals, and classes within society cannot prevent. Horkheimer articulates this as follows. Since history in the modern era consists in dependence on the irrational condition of profit instead of the rational regulation of society, individuals must adapt to the situation according to their class situation. Whilst proletarians must sell their labor power in order to survive, capitalists adapt by following the imperatives of the blind economic necessity that enslaves men, profit. They experience social reality as a subordinate but blind power, and their relationships to other men are ruled by a faceless economic necessity, which ultimately makes decisions on the fate of men. On this basis, an antagonistic developmental historical trajectory of valorization unfolds, in which productivity is rationalized through investment in the means of production and the displacement of the labor force, leading to a slowdown, business failures, the concentration of capital, the falling rate of profit, unemployment, ultimately leading to crises of reproduction. Now, as a result, the crises that inherently result from this dynamic, issuing from the present form of society, not from passive relations within society, render the individuals within society who are ruled by it incapable of redressing crises. In sum, Horkheimer characterizes the critique of political economy along the lines Reichelt indicates, as a critique of the inverted form of society in which unconscious and antagonistic class relations constitute and reproduce the socially objective dynamic of exchange, which mediates social institutions, compels individuals, and thus shapes production and reproduction in such a historical trajectory that inevitably triggers crises. So as can be seen, such an interpretation, contra post Habermasian presuppositions, views social reproduction as characterized by socially objective exchange dynamic that likewise encompasses the form of the states and civil society, while at the same time not falling prey to Dukács's fragmentary or ambivalent accounts. Moreover, as I now show, this interpretation can be deciphered in Horkheimer's seminal formulation of the critical theory of society. And in this purview, traditional and critical theory defines the object of critical theory, bourgeois society, on the basis of this interpretation of Marx's critique of political economy. Following his interpretation of Marx, Horkheimer holds that the overall framework of society is constituted and reproduced by the blind interaction of individuals with nature within the antagonistic capitalist division of labor, whose work and its results are alienated from them, possessing a fate beyond man's control. From here, Horkheimer proceeds to articulate this dynamic of production and reproduction through exchange in the manner indicated above. For this antagonistic form of collaboration creates an alienated process wherein the exchange relation dominates social reality. Mediating social production and social institutions, leading individuals to utilize their powers in accordance with the behavioral rationality of the imperative of valorization. Therefore, as with his interpretation of Marx, Horkheimer conceives of crises as issuing from this very same social dynamic of reproduction. For Horkheimer, unemployment and economic crises are an innate aspect of the whole condition of the masses due to the circumstances of production which are no longer suitable. His later discussion of the relationship between critical theory, historical trajectory, and crisis further distills this relationship. Mirroring his interpretation of capital, the concrete trajectory of domination, suffering, and misery are aligned with the crisis-ridden socially objective exchange dynamic. For the critical theory of society, thus begins with the abstract determination that characterize an economy based on exchange. The Marxian categories of commodity, value, and money, as well as class, exploitation, surplus value, profit, and pauperization. From here, more specific social elements are deduced in order to criticize concrete reality. Crises, of course, are a case in point. Yet here it is not a question of diagnosing pathological overreach of the economy or the passivity as it is instilled in the citizenry. Rather, it is a question of how these concrete elements are implicated in presupposing or reproducing this historical development, as well as its miserable ramifications. So in sum, Horkheimer's formulation of critical theory is a critical theory of society, insofar as it criticizes capitalist society in terms of the collective and antagonistic unconscious constitution and reproduction of this super-individual, autonomous, and inverted dynamic of exchange that dominates society, mediating institutions, compelling individuals to consciously and collectively reproduce it in a manner that inevitably triggers crises. Such a critique does not possess a privileged standpoint or advocate remedies within society. Rather, it proceeds to critique the autonomization of social objectivity, of exchange, by illuminating capitalist societies, the form of capitalist society's metabolic interaction with nature, and is aligned with the idea of a reasonable organization of society that will meet the needs of the whole community. Horkheimer's conception of crises as integral to the critical theory of society can then be seen to provide a more coherent and advanced explication of the Marxian aspects of Lukács' theory of reification that pointed to this relation between the critique of political economy, crisis, and the reified form of reproduction in capitalist society. For the critical theory of society is a critical theory of the reified form of reproduction in capitalist society as such. Final part. As can be seen, Horkheimer's formulation of reification in critical theory stands in distinction to Hyde, Feinberg, and Chari's reformulations. Whereas the former conceives of crisis as integral to the critique of the reified form of production and reproduction, the latter of capitalist society, the latter are shaped by post-Habermasian assumptions that replace these aspects of reification with a theory of complex differentiation that assumes the necessary neutrality and separation of the states, economy, and civil society, and thus conceives of reification in terms of deficient pathological relations of disequilibrium between these realms. Yet as I now show in closing, the very suitability of these reformulations of reification for a contemporary critical theory of society are called into question by Horkheimer's interpretation of reification, are called into question by the historical trajectory of crisis-ridden contemporary society. Horkheimer's interpretation, on the other hand, more so than Lukács's, points to a more appropriate conception of reification for contemporary critical theory, one that propounds a critical theory of the reified form of crisis-ridden social reproduction. For the present moment of crises and austerity, and indeed the historical trajectories that led to our present conjuncture, call these post-Habermasian presuppositions of complex differentiation that shaped these reconsiderations of reification, and along with it their bracketing of social reproduction and contemporary society's inherent crises tendencies into question. This is because these developments are not premised on socially differentiated spheres, non-antagonistic relations, and the neutrality of money. Nor do they stem from the passive relations individuals possess between each other or towards institutions. Rather, neoliberalism, the 2008 crisis in our present moment, can be seen as part and parcel of widespread and reciprocal ad hoc transformations within these purportedly differentiated spheres, the economy, states, civil society, for lack of a better term, that were driven by the socially objective dynamic of exchange, unfolding in a historical trajectory of reproduction that triggered crises, austerity, and misery. For as authors such as Jamie Peck, David McNally, Nick Dyer Witherford, Craig Charnock, and others have shown, economic stagnation in the 1970s compelled a state-led attack on unions, coupled with the introduction of lean production technology in the global north, outsourcing and waves of primitive accumulation in Asia. These developments led to the stagnation of wages, the emergence of surplus populations in formerly industrialized countries, the generation of waves of profits, and the subsequent rapid and pronounced polarization of wealth. A full-scale global crisis was delayed in the 1990s by the rapid state-backed development of financialization and high-risk loans. Whilst these financial instruments created a bubble that kept profits afloat until the mid-2000s, when the need to continually expand financialization led to the creation of risky practices we all know about, such as prime, subprime mortgages and derivatives. Yet, as Randy Martin has pointed out, this financial financialization of everyday life also furthered the inextricable penetration of the states into the economy, into the domain of intersubjectivity. And when the former could not be paid off due to the decline in wages and the rise in surplus population in the global north as a result of the developments as stated above, a crisis was triggered that soon spread to the financial institutions tied to these lands and eventually to the global economy, states, and civil society. Moreover, the aftermath of the financial crisis has further exemplified such a dynamic, realizing itself in a wider crisis of reproduction. For the transformation of bank debt into public debt led to waves of austerity and suffering. They were engendered by cuts in welfare, healthcare, education, pensions, public sector jobs for large sectors of Western societies. This in turn led to the further rise of surplus populations, the emergence of phenomena such as graduates with no future, structural unemployment, the persistence of stagnant wages, further indebtedness, and further immiseration. Yet it seems to me that the case of Syriza and others indicates parties that have entered office on the backs of social movements that intended to democratize these institutions have simply been forced to replicate this very same dynamic. As a whole, this trajectory indicates that these developments have been driven by a reified form of social reproduction, wherein the dynamic of valorization has encompassed the purportedly differentiated spheres of the states, civil society, compelling both sides of the class relation, and triggering crises of reproduction that have led to austerity and misery. And this in turn points to the inadequacy of these reinterpretations of reification shaped by post-Habermasian presuppositions for a critical theory of crisis-ridden society. For as we have seen, the replacement of these aspects of Marx's critique of political economy for this notion of complex differentiation, coupled with the bracketing of production, reproduction, and crises, means that these formulations of critical theory and reification are incapable not only of grasping, but also of critiquing these contemporary phenomena. Honneth's presumption of the separation of intersubjectivity from the economy, or indeed that of the neutral economy from the rest of society, seems to fly in the face of these developments. In addition, Feinberg and Chari's notion of structure and agency, passivity to depoliticization and democratization, fails to account for the domination, antagonism, and misery, such a dynamic of reproduction, simultaneously vested in the domains of the structure and the domains of agency, as well as the crisis it triggered. It also implies that remedying such a dynamic is merely a question of motivating intersubjective collective action, in which agents democratize these institutions of the structure and remedy this equilibrium, thus curing this pathology. But this, of course, offers little account of how such a process would overcome this dynamic that has encompassed these domains. Moreover, the ambivalent and undermining trajectory of Lukács' theory makes his account likewise inadequate. For on one hand, his fragmentary account of crisis does not capture such a trajectory of reproduction, whilst his conclusion would suffer from the same pitfalls as Chari and Feinberg. In contrast to these deficient accounts, these other formulations of reification provide for a present moment. It seems to me that Horkheimer articulates the basis for a contemporary critical theory of crisis-ridden social reproduction that focuses critique on the reified form of capitalist society's metabolic interaction with nature. and its constitution and reproduction of an autonomous, inverted, socially dynamic of exchange that mediates productivity and the state, compelling the interactions of social spheres and antagonistic class relations. Much like the events essayed above have unfolded in a historical trajectory that has triggered social crises, austerity, and misery. Such a notion of critical theory and reification, it seems to me, provides a promising basis for reorienting the contemporary critical theory of society in our crisis-prone and miserable present moment. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Chris. Well, we can take your questions, comments, and criticisms.
Well, maybe just the first two.
Martin?
An annoying question. Just like a clarification of some point. The difference between Lukács and Horkheimer. I mean, you were talking all the time about this, but in one simple account of the crisis in the society.
Well,
as I understand, Lukács's one is based more on real-time form, but the Horkheimer is the other way around. I mean, what interpretation of crisis is more lies on the notion of communication?
Well, I argue that Lukács only provides sort of a foreshortened account. Sorry? He only provides sort of a fragmentary and foreshortened account. He sort of looks at how crises arise from production and sort of the failure for it to be realized in exchange. But he doesn't take into account factors such as the state's role, sort of the wider social ramifications of these crises, nor of sort of their effects on the proletariat. Whereas it seems to me that Horkheimer provides sort of a more coherent and holistic account. Yeah. As I mentioned, he sees sort of all individuals and all institutions as implicated in this dynamic. So in that sense, it provides a more fully fledged account of the reified form of society qua crisis than I believe Lukács does.
So maybe, what does it mean to say that state is reified? I mean, we know the story of commodity fetishism and autonomy, this autonomous objectivity meeting the people. But when you say state is reified, it doesn't seem like the same problem.
Well, I don't really sort of get into my analysis of the states per se in this paper, but I argue elsewhere in terms of sort of the theory of reification that you, following from a Marxian form analysis, that you have to view the state as what I call sort of a form-determined instrument. It's not something that is neutral, but it is something by virtue of its sort of separate yet internally related role that it plays in capitalist society is sort of implicated in this dynamic of reproduction. Sort of the powers that it has pertain to laws, etc., that sort of reinforce production and reproduction.
Anyone else? If not, we can finish for today, and next week there will be some conference talking about relativity and psychoanalysis.